Shalom everyone, I am Gabriel and welcome, whether you are here live or catching up on YouTube. We are exploring Deuteronomy chapter 3, verse 23 to chapter 7, verse 11, and I plead. The key points of our study: listen, do, and teach them that you may live and possess the land. YouTube viewers, subscribe and comment and give us a like. Online meeting participants, engage in the chat, please. So let's begin, and thank you once again. Today we're going to learn about the lesson of it's not me, or do not take responsibility for my sin, or the disease of the sinner, or is nothing wrong with me, which is the disease of the 21st century. So we have the case of Moshe. Our study starts with chapter 3, verse 23. We read in chapter 3, verse 26, speak no more unto me of this matter. Sentence made, no more objections. Why? Moshe's mission is close to an end and is not going to enter the promised land. That's a fact. So let's read chapter 3, verse 26. We're going to read only the blue one first. That's the original text. But Yahweh was wroth with me for your sakes and would not hear me. And Yahweh said unto me, let it suffice thee. Speak no more unto me of this matter. Surprising statement. Yahweh was right in not letting him enter the promised land. Basically, Moshe is in the way he wrote, he made this statement, he did not take responsibility and he did not admit that he was wrong. He said, Yahweh was wroth on the bottom. We read on the bottom, Yahweh was wroth because of you and would not hear me. It's not me. All because of you, but it's not me. He is not saying I did commit a sin, I upset Yah, I take responsibility for what I did, I deserve the punishment. It is my fault because I didn't enter the promised land. He didn't say that, and that's why he didn't make it. Now let's go back to the text and read verse 26, including the red. But Yahweh was wroth with me. He applied the law, a severe judge. For your sakes, you are the problem, you are the cause. And do not hear me. I don't know why, it's not me. And Yahweh said unto me, speak no more unto me of this matter. Absolutely not. Where is this coming from? The attitude comes straight from the Garden of Eden. Absolutely. So we have Adam's view. And the man said, the woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. It is not me. But he chose. He was not forced. Adam was not forced. He chose. But he indirectly, he said, it's not me. It's not my problem. Eve's view. Yahweh Elohim said unto the woman, what is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me, and I did eat. I was seduced by the serpent. She was not forced either. She chose. Again, it is not me. It is the serpent. So we have, it is the woman, the serpent, and Moshe version, for your sake, it's not me, viewpoint or perspective on, or understanding. Our lesson, when we do not admit our wrongdoing, our sin, is no forgiveness for that. we will suffer the consequences. Moshe did not make it there because of his attitude, because of his thinking. Moshe lost words, particular statutes, judgments, and laws. Chapter 4, verse 2. You shall not add unto the word, neither shall you diminish. It's the sin of this generation. Saturday Sabbath is added just to fit in, and is diminishing the true one. Interpretation out of context are the cause. So think about it, of this statement about the Saturday Sabbath. So you should not add unto the word, neither shall you diminish. Absolutely not. Saturday, it's right there. Chapter 4, verse 6, guard and do them, for this is your wisdom and understanding in the sight of the nations. Is not about talking. In his sight, is about doing. You will be my representatives in front of the nation, in front of other nations. Verse 7, what other nation has Elohim so close to them? No other nation experienced that type of relationship. The most unique in the history of the world. Not enough mentioned and emphasized. Absolutely not. They were the most privileged nation on the planet Earth. They experienced true greatness, which we found in verse 8. What other nation is so great to have commandments and judgments? Order, discipline, responsibility, and morality, blessings that they received thousands of years ago. Certain countries do not have this, not even today in 2023. The privilege to live in order, discipline, responsibility, and morality. In verse 9, take heed. Only take heed to thyself, and keep thy soul diligently, lest thou forget the things which thy eyes have seen, and lest they depart from thy heart all the days of thy life. But teach them thy sons and thy sons' sons. Do not forget your history. Do not forget what you experienced. Do not forget what you heard. You are a new person with a special call and mission, because from now on you are in charge of the teaching. You are the example of your sons and future generations. Did ever people hear the voice of Elohim speaking out of the midst of fire? Unto you was shown that Yahweh is Elohim and is no other besides him. Great experience. Chapter 4, verse 16. Do not corrupt yourself. Do not make any graven images similar to a male or female. Do not associate me with anything human-like. Verse 20. Even out of Mitzrayim, out of Egypt, a people of inheritance as you this day. What is the message of I took you out of Mitzrayim? It is mentioned many times across the Torah, constantly. It's a constant reminder. I took you out of Mitzrayim, out of Egypt. Why is it mentioned in the Ten Commandments? The Exodus took place first, and then the law was given. Why is this message for the modern world too? What's the point even to include this in the Ten Commandments? Throughout this Torah study, we have the emphasis on guarding, doing, teaching, walking, binding, and writing them. Commandments, statutes, and judgments. And we have the verses enlisted below. Answer. Is necessary to mention out of Mizraim for the modern world? Is it a mistake? Is Elohim making mistake? Some suggest that the law is a historical event and we are no longer bound to it. Some suggest that the Shabbat is no longer to be observed. Yahweh is not making any mistake. It's us that need to listen to him in adjusting our life based on his moral values. The process of taking you out of the world of sin is not finished yet. I am still able to take you out of the world of sin, and you still need to come out. I cannot come into the world of sin to save you if you think, plan, and execute sin. Israel's mission was based on what they saw and experienced, to guard, to do, and teach all the way to the end of times the reality of Yahweh and his law. The fact that I took you out of Mizraim is in the Ten Commandments tell us that the solution is in the law, in guarding and keeping the law. That's why we have the reminder, I took you out of slavery, out of Mizraim, out of Egypt. Verse 25, and it shall be our righteousness if we observe to do all these commandments before the Yahweh our Elohim, as he had commanded us. So the solution for us is the Ten Commandments. The modern world concludedly they came up with their own conclusion. They reject the solution and the only one. Consequences of rebellion and sin. Chapter 4, 25 to 28. If you make a graven image or evil in the sight of Yahweh, heaven and earth as witnesses, that you shall utterly be destroyed. Why such a dramatic punishment? And we have the answers in chapter 4, 36 to 39. Because you heard his voice for instructions, and he showed his presence in fire. You heard and saw. Everything you experienced was real. You experienced like no other, more than reading in a book about what happened in the past. You experienced that in the present. So the consequences, you shall be scattered among nations. You'll be left few in number and without him as your leader. You shall serve Elohim of wood and stone. Because of that, you will no longer be able to communicate with me, with Yahweh, with him. You will do it with Elohim of wood and stone. They will be your guidance from now on if you do not listen. That's basically the message. No more me, the only true Yahweh, the only one that breathes life. It's unbelievable. They place on them a lot of responsibility, a lot of privileges, but in the same time are consequences. Absolutely, no question about it. The solution for every human being is found in chapter 4, verse 29. But if from thence thou shalt seek Yahweh thy Elohim, thou shalt find him, if you thou seek him with all thy heart and with all thy soul. Now we know the reason for the confusion and why is not present in our lives. If we want Yahweh closer, the search must be done from all our heart. Absolutely. Their call, it's our call. Thou shalt keep therefore his statutes and his commandments, which I command thee this day, that it may go well with thee and with thy children after thee, that thou may prolong thy days upon the earth, which the Yahweh thy Elohim giveth thee forever. So that was not only for them. Was only for us, absolutely. In chapter 5, we have the law. So in verse 7, you should have no other Elohim, no other power or authority to be accepted. Guard the day of the Shabbat to sanctify it, as Yahweh Eloheka has commanded you, in verse 12. So the commandment to sanctify the Sabbath day is not coming from the Pope. Absolutely not. These two verses combined teach us that, one, we should not have other authority than himself, than the Creator. Two, the true Sabbath belongs to him. And three, no other Elohim should establish the Sabbath day for you. In chapter 5, verse 25, we read, and you said, behold, Yahweh Eloheinu has shown us his glory, his greatness, and we have heard his voice out of the midst of fire. We see this day that Yahweh does talk with men, and he liveth. For who is there of all flesh that heard the voice of the living Elohim speaking out of the midst of fire, as we have and lived? Nobody else on the planet Earth experienced what they did. Absolutely. There's no question about that. Chapter 6, verse 2. That though my fear Yahweh Eloheka to keep all his statutes and his commandments, which I command thee, thou and thy son and thy son's sons, all the days of thy life, and that days may be prolonged. Fear him. Why? After all you saw and felt and heard, you need to understand and accept his authority. That's the meaning of that. Encourage others to do the same and become a real example. He didn't make them fear him or be afraid of him. He revealed himself in his might and glory, and he deserved the utmost respect. Chapter 6, verse 4, Yahweh is one. He is not three persons. Absolutely not. Verse 5, you shall love him with all your heart and with all your soul, and these words shall be in your heart. Teach them diligently to your children, and buy them for a sign. Write them on your post of the house and your gates. How come they receive a command to love? Can they be forced to love? I devoted myself to you entirely. This is what is his message towards them and towards us. You shall be devoted to me also. Your emotion, thoughts, strength, resources, or abilities should be put for my cause and no other. I am the only true Elohim and is no other. Complete loyalty and devotion to me. Can you do that? Have you learned anything from me? Chapter 7, verse 2. No covenant with nations or people that do not have respect for me or my laws. They will turn you away from me to serve other Elohim, to anger Yahweh and destroy you suddenly. Because you experienced like no other nation on earth, you heard me talking, you saw my physical presence, you already know that there is no other Elohim besides me, and you are not to worship them like you did at Peor. You worship fallen angels. Destroy their altars, break down their images, cut down their poles, burn their images with fire. Chapter 7, verse 6, for you are holy people unto Yahweh Eloheka. Yahweh Eloheka had chosen thee to be a special people unto himself, above all people that are upon the face of the earth. Is this coming through a genetic line? Are you holy people because you have a special gene or because I choose you and educate you to become like me? We need to remember the solution is in the law. Chapter 6, verse 25, and it shall be our righteousness if we observe to do all these commandments before Yahweh Eloheinu as he had commanded us. What is righteousness? A state of being aligned with moral principle of our Elohim, total obedience to the moral standard, his will and purposes. Our obedience counted as righteousness. How can we obtain the state of being righteous? Based on knowing him, we receive the power to accept forgiveness and implement the moral standard in our lives. Salvation is not dependent solely on faith, but on the life of obedience to him. This is Deuteronomy 6:25. We are holy and righteous in keeping the law. The law tells us that we are sinners and in desperate need of a Savior. In keeping the law, you cannot obtain salvation, but you understand your need for forgiveness and salvation. So we keep the law, the Ten Commandments, we fail, we sin, we admit failure, and we ask for forgiveness. Then we realize that we are in need of a Savior greater than the law to offer forgiveness. And salvation is because of him only. That's the meaning of keeping the law. You keep the law, we keep the law, we accept Messiah, Yahusha HaMashiach, as our Savior. We reject the law, we reject him also. Yahusha is our salvation. He kept all commandments, and our salvation is based on his obedience and supreme sacrifice. In accepting him, we do not discard the law. We enforce it. Absolutely. So what happened when we do not keep the law? So now, not keeping the law means grace, and some people are saying, well, I don't want to live under the tyranny of the law. Well, if you don't need the law, that means you do not fail. You don't have a standard. You do not know if you are wrong or right. So in this case, you do not sin, is not me, is nothing wrong with me, I am good. So in that case is no admission of guilt. And the result is no forgiveness needed and no forgiveness given. The conclusion is no need for a Savior. You reject HaMashiach. You reject Yahusha HaMashiach, mission and person and everything about what he is. Basically, you say, we can do it in our own, we are not so bad, it's someone else, it's not me, I am need of nothing. Salvation is in any circumstance. Everybody goes to heaven. No consequences of not respecting the law and in rejecting his offer of a free forgiveness. That it will be applicable to all those who sin no more. So she said, no man Adonai, and Yahusha said unto her, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. The law is sending us into his mighty hands, not to condemn us, but to save us. Without the law is no need for a Savior. If we eliminate the law, who is he then? Why did he come to the planet Earth just to be crucified? Think not that I come to destroy the Torah or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. When you say total obedience to his law, that means that the Sabbath day will be the one established by him. and not the one established by Rome. Guard the Sabbath day to sanctify it as Yahweh Eloheka had commanded thee. He did the command. Nobody else. Nobody else is entitled to do that. What is hypocrisy? It is a state where you pretend to do a certain thing. Convenience is one of the reasons why people practice pretending. To place the brain in the state of pretending means that you'll never be able to reach the truth because you are still in the pretending mode, which is very confusing for our state of mind. To pretend that Saturday is the Sabbath day means that you'll never be able to discover the true one because you are pretending and defending the wrong one. Instead of follow me, you follow the state of pretending and defending in his name. So how come his holy people are not liked and barely accepted anywhere? The law is the solution offered to a sinful world for redemption, and the same law became the weapon used against them. The world is rejecting the law and sees as the problem and not as a solution. This is upside down thinking, absolutely. It's confusion. The reason that they were chosen was not because of a great number, but because he loved you and guarded the oath which he had sworn out to your fathers, brought you out with a mighty hand, redeemed you out of the house of bondmen from the land of Mitzrayim, chosen and special because of his presence in their lives. His presence made them special. Know therefore that Yahweh Eloheka, his Elohim, the faithful El, which keep the covenant and mercy with them that love him and keep his commandments to a thousand generations, and repay them that hate him to their face, to destroy them. He will not be slack to him that he hated him. He will repay him to his face. All those who hate him and his law will be confronted openly and visibly, with no delay, in a way that will be evident to all. That's the meaning. Verse 11, thou shalt therefore keep the commandments, keep them, and the statutes and the judgments which I commanded this day, to do them, not to talk about them. In his sight is about doing, and no one has the power to change that. Summary. Do not add or diminish my words. You saw miracles like no other nation. It shall be clear to you who I am and understand my requirements. You represent me to other nations. My laws, guard them, do them, and teach others to receive the blessing promised. Do not forget who you are and what you experience. Do not become corrupt in making images to represent me. Heaven and earth are witnesses against you. There will be consequences if you don't respect the covenant. You will be scattered among the nations, and you shall be left few in number. Do not accept other authority besides me to define my law, especially the Sabbath day. I told you that I am one. Love me with your heart and soul. Teach your children diligently my laws. Keeping the law is your righteousness. I choose you to be my holy people. I keep my covenants. I am faithful. To all those who hate me, be sure that you know why, because it's going to be an open confrontation and witnesses will be involved. Hear the statutes and the judgments to do them, that you may live and go and possess the land, is the same formula for 2023. Absolutely, no question about it. Oh, everyone that thirst, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money, Come you buy and eat. Yes, come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Where in this world an offer like that can be found? Who is offering a relationship of this preeminence and importance? Who is offering the most? Himself and eternal life. And everyone is invited. And I close with Revelation 22:12-14. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work shall be. I am Aleph and Tav, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have the right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gates into the city. Amen.
And also, for those of you that are watching this on YouTube, please like if this is a blessing to you, and please share it with your friends that love Yeshua.